I want to remind you that I'm trying to get you to think, not get you to agree with me. I do believe in soul competency, which means that every believer has the right to interpret the Bible and that we'll stand before God for what we believe the Bible says and how we lived it. But I want to remind you that soul competency does not trump scriptural authority. The authority is the Bible, not anybody's interpretation of the Bible. Now, we have to live in light of what we believe the Bible says. And we give freedom for Christians to do that. But when all is said and done, it's a fair question to ask anyone about any subject related to religion. Can you show me in the Bible where you believe that, why you believe that? I think that's a fair question. Now, because the Bible is treated so badly in some ways, proof text, made literal when it's not literal, taken out of context, all kinds of terrible things are done to it, I'm so glad that you've come to participate in a series of weeks training on maybe a better approach. Now, I must admit to you that I am trying in these early hours to get your attention. I've got to convince you we're not doing it well for you to be open to a radically new way of looking and dealing with the Bible on a personal level. And my goal is that you have a deep desire to self-feed on the Word of God. I want to encourage and empower God's people to self-feed. It cannot be a new pastor's responsibility to help you grow spiritually. It's not your Sunday school teacher's responsibility to help you grow spiritually. It's your responsibility. And whenever we say, well, it's my wife does that, or my pastor does that, or the deacon, friends, it's your responsibility as a child of God to know the Word of God. I'm going to start in the middle of a section because I didn't quite finish last week. So if you have brought last week's notes with you, and I hope you did, I'd like to go to page 8, number C. It's just, and then I'll get to the Bible because that's the whole issue. That's the major thrust of tonight. I will not finish the notes you have tonight, so bring them back. I'll not be here next week. When I came, I'd already made some commitments to some churches for the winter Bible study, and it's not fair for me to cancel those. I've done them for these churches, some of them for 10 and 12 years in a row. So I had some commitments I had to uphold, and next week was one of them. I'm so glad to be back this week because I really didn't want to leave a two-week gap in between this. And I thank you again for coming. Number C is the historical grammatical method's basic approach. Now, I've said to you that the historical grammatical method is the only method that it provides consistency and verification. And that consistency and verification comes from the intent of the original author, which is the only inspired person in Bible study. No modern author, no modern preacher, no modern teacher is inspired. The canon is closed. Jude, once and for the faith, once and for all given to the saints, Jude 3 and 20. The definite article with the word faith in Acts, the faith. This is a way of referring to the truths about Jesus. We don't need golden plates and special glasses. We don't need new revelations. Everything we need to know about God, how to live for Him, everything we know to get to heaven, we already have. And the issue is we must spend more time knowing that. So here is my understanding of the basic approach of this method, which, as I hope you remember from last time, is a reaction to the allegorical school of Alexandria, Egypt, that developed in the city of Antioch of Syria several hundred years later. This is exactly the approach of the classical reformers, Martin Luther, John Calvin. This is exactly the approach of Precepts Ministry. This is exactly the approach of many, many conservative groups that you know, so it's nothing new. What I've done is taken an ancient Bible study approach, and I've put some structure on it. And the structure I put on it is to make sure that we don't jump logical ways of interpreting text because we get used to it. And the analogy I use with you is professional pilots who've taken off and landed tens of thousands of times still go through a checklist. Because the human mind, even one that's trained and committed and serious, still has a tendency to skip steps. So this is meant to be a checklist on, have I done this before I say, thus saith the Lord? Before I teach something in God's name, have I paid the price to know what the original author was saying to his day? And that's my definition of biblical authority. Okay, number one. It is the only method of interpretation that provides controls on interpretation. It also allows limited verification and consistency. Authorial intent, contextual, grammatical, lexical, and historical insights. Now, I'm going to go back over that again. How do I think I know the original author's intent? Well, first of all, I'm not sure I do. I'm trying to. But it's obvious if I want to understand what the person who wrote it said, I've got to do a few things. I've got to try to put myself back into the original hearer's place, historically, culturally. I've got to read all that that author read, wrote, not just part of it. I just can't pick a verse out here and a verse out there. I've got to read the entire literary presentation. That's only fair. You would be mad if I pulled something out of one of your letters. No, we've got to read the whole letter. Why did he write it? Who did he write it to? When did he write it? What did he say? These are the issues. So there's six areas that we're trying to bring evidence from when we can. Now, it's not evidence that is absolutely it's not going to be foolproof. It's not scientific. It's not that. It's literary evidence, textual evidence. It's lexical evidence. So we're looking from the history of the day. We're looking for the literary context of the passage or paragraph. We're looking to unique grammatical features of that language. We're looking for what the words meant in that day. We're looking for the type of literature or genre that it is, and we're looking for parallel passages, because the best interpreter of an inspired text is an inspired text. So six areas that I can bring evidence from. Now, this is meant to make the history of the author and the whole writing of the author the focus of my interpretation. Now, people say to me all the time, well, the Holy Spirit told me. All right, let's just deal with that. Thank God the Holy Spirit speaks to you. I have no problems with that. And if you believe the Holy Spirit has interpreted a text to you in a way, then you must obey what you believe the Spirit said to you. But I don't have to obey it unless it's clearly taught in Scripture. Amen? You can't put your insights on me because your insights are not authority. Now, they may be meaningful, sincere for you, and you must walk in the light you have. But other Christians don't have to walk in the light you have. Because nobody said that your interpretation is God's interpretation. Amen? Pretty weak, but... These kind of areas provide insight for a rational interpretation and evaluation of the interpretation of others. I hear some sermons that are very clever. I hear some sermons I agree with, but the text they got it from has nothing to do with what they just said. And I have no way to evaluate that. They say, well, I prayed about it. This is what God told me. I need a way to critique who I hear who is speaking in God's name. And that's true for a local church, because I guarantee you, when pastors come through here, they do not have the same emphasis in theology. And you've got to know your Bible well enough to protect yourself from sincere speakers. You get 13 Baptist preachers up here, you've got 35 opinions on most subjects. Which means you must know what you believe and why. I think we're guilty of saying, if the guy wears a black suit and preaches behind a pulpit and came from a credible seminary, it must be true. I know some real jerks with the seminary with me. This is a quote from Gordon Fee. A Bible that can mean anything means nothing. It's like a wax figure. If one can put the nose over here, one can put the nose over here, one can put the nose up here. If it can mean anything, it means nothing. There's got to be some rational, textual, historical, contextual, lexical, grammatical evidence of why I think it means that. Then I've got to give you the dignity of saying, pray about this, read it, and let your Holy Spirit filter cause you to walk in the light you have. It is not a method for scholars. Holy spit. We have allowed scholars to take away the Bible that was given to us and not them. They do not call it Koine Greek for nothing. This is not written in the language of the academy. This is written in the language of the street. This is the second language of commerce of the Greco-Roman world. It was written for the common person. That's who God intends to speak with it. Now, thank God for scholars. They help us in technical areas. But I guarantee you, how many PhDs do you think you need to interpret the Bible? That's the problem. We begin to be intimidated. If I got 13 PhDs up here in the same area, they wouldn't agree on anything. Human knowledge is not the key to Bible study. You, the Bible, and the Holy Spirit are priority in Bible study. You say, well, what if I get it wrong? Join the club. We have to walk in the light we have, open to more light from Scripture and the Spirit. We have to love one another even if we're different. I hope you'll read Romans 14, 1 through 15, 13 on the weaker and stronger brother, and both of them are in this church. They're in every church. It is not a method for scholars, but for the common man, faith-seeking understanding. However, difference in languages, culture, require research. It must be interpreted in light of the original author's purpose, historical setting, and literary context. People always say to me, are you telling me that I got to know history to interpret the Bible? That's exactly what I'm telling you. That's exactly what I'm saying to you. Because you don't know anything about a Jewish wedding feast on your own. You don't know how they raise cattle, how they cook bread, how they dressed. None of us know that because we're Americans in the 20th and 21st century. But this book is 2,000 years old in a Greco-Roman first century, or if Old Testament, much older than that. Of course the Bible is not the morning newspaper. Of course we've got to do a little study to get ourselves back in the historical setting of the day. If the original author's intent is the key to Bible interpretation, if he really is the only inspired person, the logic of it is, we've got to try to put ourselves in the place of the original hearers. It just seems so logical to me. This is called the common sense method of interpreting anything that's written. Anything. Interpretation is a focused attempt to use the same procedures done unconsciously in ordinary human communication through written text. It involves an understanding of, now let me stop for a minute. I've said this before, I'll just reiterate quickly. I believe that part of the image of God is our ability to communicate verbally. That's why the Bible talks about creation with a spoken word. That's why Isaiah 55 says, 11, his word does not go out void without accomplishing his purpose. That's why Jesus is called the Word of God. We must be able to communicate to other rational, normal human beings what we believe and why. So, when you read a newspaper, your mind, that wonderful gift from God, damaged though it may be in the fall, you know immediately, within a sentence or two, this is humor, this is sarcasm, this is an editorial comment, this is meant to be a fact-based article. You know that. And how do you know that? Because this wonderful gift of linguistic communication given by God. So what do we do? What type of literature is this? Now, if you're expecting, I taught Revelation at First Baptist West Monroe Saturday. There was 700 people there. It's a really, really good group. And you're trying to get their attention. So you say, you know, if you believe this is all literal, the Bible says there's a whore that sits on seven hills. That's a big whore. If you're expecting a dragon to chase a woman across the night sky, friends, cancel your subscription to the Sci-Fi Channel because you've been warped. I'm in college. This guy asked me, he said, do you believe the Bible? I said, yeah. He said, I told you, you believe that trees skip like rams and the hills clap their hands? I think that's poetry. I knew you didn't believe the Bible. Give me a break. Just be a normal person. If you read a poem, do you take it literally? Then why do Americans, because we're Westerners, think that if you really believe something, you take it literally? Well, that's true if it's historical narrative. We're not denying anything, miracles, events. We're just saying if it's poetry or prophecy or apocalyptic or parable, it's not literal. Now, what kind of genre is this we're studying? Second, the contemporary meaning of terms. What did these words mean to the author? And the way you find that out, these are Hebrew, the writers of the New Testament, Hebrew thinkers writing street Greek. Hebrew thinkers writing street Greek. So you don't go to a Greek lexicon. You go to the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, and see how they use these words. That's where the theology is coming from. The Septuagint was the Bible of the early church. Historical and cultural settings. We've got to know something of the day. We've got to. I'll give you an example. This parable of the Pharisee and the sinner. You and I automatically know the Pharisee is a bad guy when we read the parable. But I want you to know, in that day, the Pharisee was Billy Graham. The Pharisees were thought of as the most conservative, most godly people around. And we know, we come with a bias that they're bad and miss the whole point of the parable because of our cultural conditioning that's exactly opposite of the original hearers, who would have seen this as a wonderful godly person. And Jesus takes that wonderful godly person to task with a simple sinner's prayer. Got to be careful. We read the whole literary unit before we try to interpret the part. That's logic. If I wrote you a 10-page letter, you wouldn't read to page 2 and quit. You wouldn't call me mad because of something I said on page 3 and never even read 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 pages. Well, then why in the world will we let somebody take the first chapter of a book and tell us something that the whole book is never talking about? Number 4, the difficulties in interpreting an ancient text multiply because, number 1, knowledge of any given language from the past is limited. I always get tickled. People say, oh, I have 3 years of Greek. So what? You don't speak Greek at all, ancient Greek. Nobody speaks ancient Greek. If you had 3 years of any modern language, you wouldn't even be on a sixth grade level in that language. Don't you tell me you're some kind of expert in Greek because you've had 3 or 4 years of it. And I always get tickled when somebody from some seminary says you mispronounce a Greek word. Like you know, fool. We don't even use the inflections of the original language, and we've put a phonetic alphabet on a Greek alphabet. And Greek people can't speak Koine Greek and understand it. I'm over it, shoot. We never know if we have the author's intent. It's always an assumption. We're never sure of the exact purposes of these genres. I've said to you that the genre that the author chooses to communicate his message is a contract with the reader on how to interpret it. But we're not always sure we understand exactly what that genre is implying. There are idioms. Now, these idioms, if you take an idiom as literal, you're an idiot. You know, pluck out your eye and cut off your hand. People say, I just take the Bible literally. You do not. Not one of you are eyeless. You're 6 sins away from being a blind paraplegic. You don't take it literally at all. Don't you tell me you take it literally. We pick and choose what we take literally based on our traditions. Now, what I'm saying to you is, let's be consistent to the type of literature that the author chooses to write in. It requires that one must attempt to ascertain the original author's intent. The following are basic content questions we should ask every passage, and I would say at least a paragraph. Now, these are my questions. These are not inspired. These are not unique. I'm asking you to try this a couple of times on a small New Testament book. After you try it, write your own questions. I'm trying to capture the method of the ancient school from Antioch of Syria. Here are the questions. You can follow. And the rest of this notebook is going to be something of an explication of these questions. Number 1, what did the original author say? Textual criticism. I'm going to talk about that some tonight if I have time. We'll get into it next time when I deal with your next set of outlines called the Bible. So, for sure. The second one is, what did the original author mean? Now, this is where grammar and word studies come in. Exegesis. The third one is, what did the original author say elsewhere? This is parallel passage. The best parallel passage is the same author in the same book, then the same author in other books. So it moves in concentric circles of significance to the whole Bible. This is parallel passages. What did other biblical authors say? How did the original hearers understand it? Sometimes we have a clue. Most of the time it's in the Gospels or in Acts that we know who the target group is and how they responded to the message. We understand what was being communicated by the way the audience responds to it. And sometimes they respond exactly opposite of what the author intended. How does this apply to my day and how does it apply to my life? Bible study is knowing what it meant then and then applying that truth to my life with the same power and intensity. Every text has one and only one meaning, the intent of the original author. Every text has many applications or significances based on the need of the recipient culture. But our task, this is where our creativity comes in, is to apply the Bible author's message to our day with the same power. What's a task? Some general statements about this seminar. Sin affects everyone. It surely affects me. I have tried to humble myself before you. I've tried to say, I know I'm a sinner. It's affected me. I know I'm historically conditioned. I've been to Baptist schools. I realize that. We all wear filters, glasses with different levels of spiritual gift and personality and mama and culture and denomination. We all have them. If we know we have them, we can limit their effect. But if you think, oh no, I just read the Bible, then you really got them. So what we've got to do is recognize, first of all, that God wants to communicate with us, and the problem is not with the sender, it's with the receiver. I don't often hear what he's trying to say. This sin affects not only my interpretation, but my systematization and implication of truth. Filter what is presented through your Spirit-led understanding. You have the Holy Spirit too. If what I say, just red lights go off, check my biblical evidence. And then you must decide. Number two, new insights and theological adjustments are painful but necessary. Now, the little thing I usually say here is, if you have not had a new thought about God in the last 5 years, you're brain dead. Did you think this stopped the minute you trusted Christ? You never heard of growing in Christ? You have no new insights in reading the Bible and coming to worship and reading Sundays. You have not thought anything new about God. Nothing has changed in your understanding of God in 5 years. Well, something's sick. Something's wrong. You're meant to grow into Christ's likeness all your life. We can't quit growing. You say, well, I got white hair. Join the club. You're not dead yet, are you? Then God expects you to know the Bible. Your grandkids need you to know the Bible. Your culture needs you to know the Bible. You don't get retired from knowing the Bible. Let me challenge your traditions. Let me slap Fiddler on the Roof and see if they're biblical. In order to help our understanding, this seminar will employ every hair pull Baptist I've ever had, I'm going to bring up. Now, do you think I can solve those things? Croak, no, I know that. But I'm going to pour those worms on the table. We'll look at those. I can't get those worms back in the jar. Interims can do wonderful things with worms. This is what I want to do. I want to show valid, alternate, conservative interpretations. I want to show inappropriate biblical interpretations. And as a word here, hermeneutics can never tell you what a text means. But hermeneutics can tell you what the text cannot mean. And if I've got five possibilities, five theories in church history, five denominational understandings, if I can limit two or three of those through hermeneutical principles of original author's intent, original historical setting, unique grammatical features, contemporary meaning of words, genre, and parallel passages, even though I don't know exactly what it means, I think I've come a long way from five to two. So let's present the two and give the people of God the chance to let their spiritual gift, mind, and heart kick in. Please don't get so mad at me in these illustrations that you forget that I'm trying to illustrate Bible interpretation principles. I'm using these examples to illustrate. I'm not trying to convince you they're right or want you to change. I'm using the examples as illustrations of improper and proper hermeneutical procedures to text. My approach, which I call the donkey and the 2x4, will get and keep your attention. It will. If I don't make you mad and you choose to come back, it'll go by fast. Number D, examples are meant to illustrate methodology. They're not meant to be definitive, but thought-provoking. Christian maturity is a painful, tension-filled road of self-examination and spirit-led Bible study. Amen? Number five, I just added this recently. Why take the time to study hermeneutics? Believers must be able to self-feed. Too many Christians are tricked and sidetracked by minor issues. Believers must participate in regular Bible study, both corporately and individually. Believers must remember how great a privilege it is to have a written revelation from God. But this privilege is an awesome, ongoing, spiritual responsibility for our families, for our friends, and for our faith communities. Well, that's the end of that section. Let me go quickly now and start the section on the Bible. And, of course, the section on the Bible is meant to say, why are you... I think if I'm going to try to talk about how to interpret the Bible, it's important that I talk about the Bible up front. And, I'll just get into it. Roman numeral 1, these are my general presuppositions. Number 1, God exists. It's a presupposition. And He wants us to know Him. See, I think most of my life, I thought if I don't spit, dance, or chew and go with those who do and attend church every time and tithe a little bit over and witness every day, then maybe God will share information with me. See, that's that performance-based model that is so sick. God wants to communicate to His children. He is screaming as loud as He can scream. He gave you a written revelation because He loves you. He sent His Son to fully reveal Himself. He wants you to know Him. He wants to communicate. So if you say to me, I read the Bible, I don't get anything out of it, something is wrong. If you're reading the Bible and not getting anything, you got a translation that you don't understand, or you're not using the right methods to approach it. That's just the way that it is. God wants to speak to you. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? The Bible should not be hard to understand. The Spirit was a clear writer. So something is getting in the way. What is it? It's Fiddler on the Roof. It's traditions. It's proof-texting. It's literalizing. It's reading the Bible like the morning newspaper. It's being too independent and selfish, thinking everybody is writing directly to you. Those are barriers, filters we've got to overcome. God has revealed Himself. I'm committed to that. He acted in history. We call that revelation. He created. He created Adam. He called Noah. He called Abraham. He led the children of Israel out of Egypt. God has acted. Revelation. Revealed Himself. Then He has chosen certain persons to record and explain what He's done. We call that inspiration. The writers of the Scripture. Then the Spirit illumines the hearts and minds of readers. But now here's the problem. In this room right here, if I threw out any modern contemporary issue, we would not agree on it. And I don't believe the Bible disagrees on anything. Paradoxes, yes, but disagree, no. So what happens is that inspiration is a higher order than illumination. So I can't let soul competency trump inspiration. Your opinion is valid for you, but it's not valid for me. Unless you can show me your scriptural evidence and give me the freedom to pray about it and check it out. It's literary limits. Now this is about, is the Bible I have the only inspired books? And I must admit to you, this is probably the largest presuppositional jump that any of us ever make. And this is presuppositional. I mean, just because you got one that's covered in leather and written in different colored inks and got satin ribbons doesn't mean that that's the only inspired word. And this is the whole issue of the Gospel of Thomas that just sparked the Da Vinci Code. And all these stupid books about the hidden books of the Bible. They're not hidden. The church threw them out. There's nothing hidden about this deal. If you read those books, you'd go, this is crazy. By the way, if you want to read them, they're in the Ante-Nicene Fathers in any big library. 38 volumes. Read all you want to. Throw up and come back to church. The Protestant canon... 27 books of the New Testament, is a historical process that is sometimes not very pretty. Basically, the church accepted the canon of the Jews. There is the Old Testament Apocrypha, I know, but the Jews never accepted that, so the church never accepted that. Now, even those churches that do Episcopal, they still don't base doctrine on the Episcopal church, though they say they're good to be read for Christian education. Roman Catholic Church does base doctrine on some of these, not the Apocrypha, but the Pseudepigrapha, some additional books in the New Testament, which were included in some of these lists. Example, the whole doctrine of purgatory comes from the Shepherd of Hermas. But the Shepherd of Hermas, a very popular book in the early church, was rejected by the church as being part of the canon, as was so many others. So, how do we know this is it? Now, this is assumed. No, the Bible doesn't say this anywhere. This is assumed. Assumed canonization principles. Number B, it had to be connected to Jesus or an apostle. Now, you say, what about Luke? Well, he's connected to Paul. Or what about John Mark? Well, he records Peter's sermons in Rome to write the Gospel of Mark. Has to be connected to Jesus or an apostle. Walked with him, heard him, or an apostle. Two, a theological unity with apostolic teaching. If I know these are from Paul or James or John or whatever, the Gospels, and I got a book over here that claims to be from a Christian source, and this new book disagrees with what I know is an apostolic source, the new book goes. There has to be a theological unity with apostolic truth. Number D, I do not believe that the Roman Catholic Church set the canon in 325 at the Council of Nicaea. I believe that local churches around the Mediterranean world, years before that, begin to decide what books have power and what books don't. And one of the ways they decided this, when some of these books are read, people's lives are permanently, morally, radically changed. And this is how they begin to know which books have power to communicate the truth. And this is one of the principles we assume, that people's lives were permanently changed. Now, number E, I've tried to list for you some of the list of these scriptures that you and I know as the 27 books of the New Testament, and it didn't happen immediately. The first list we have is Origen, the brightest light in the early church. He admits to us there are four Gospels and the Epistles of the Apostle, which is probably the writings of Paul, that were in circulation in his day. He lived at the end of the second century and the beginning of the third. The Muratorian Fragment, which is from Rome. Some say 180, some say 200 A.D., is also a list of canonical books. There's a couple books in there that we don't have, but it's very close to the 27 books that we do have. Eusebius, right in the 3rd century, began to list three kinds of Christian books, those that are accepted by all churches, some that are disagreed on by some churches, and those that are rejected by all churches. Now, our 27 comes in the first two categories, accepted by all, disputed by some. And some of the historical development is ugly. You know, you got two centers of the empire. You got one in the east and one in the west as the church developed. Well, the Western church liked one book, the Eastern church liked another, but they wouldn't accept each other's. Talking about Revelation and Hebrews. Finally, the emperor said, we all quit fighting, accept both of them. Now, that's the way it happened, and it's ugly. And you just believe the Holy Spirit was involved, but that's the kind of thing that happens in this canonization. This book didn't fall out of the sky and knock Martin Luther off a donkey. There's a list from North Africa in 360 called the Cheltenham List that is almost exactly the 27. The first one that is exactly the same as our New Testament is Athanasius' Easter Letter. I think it's in 367. That's the first one exactly like ours. But the process of getting a canon has been a slow process. But I do believe the canon is closed. I heard somebody say, I wish I could remember their name. They said, if it's new, it's not for you. I agree with that. If there's a new letter of Paul found, I would not put it in the canon. We have everything we need to know Jesus Christ, give our lives to Him, and live pleasing to Him. The problem is not we need more information. The problem is we're not reading and studying the information we already have. I've given you some suggested readings. I hope you'll look at that. Now, I'm watching the time, lest God forbid I break into a Baptist business meeting. Roman numeral 3. Let's talk about the Bible speak for itself. Now, some say to me, you're using circular reasoning. Yes, I have to. If I'm committed to the Bible as the only source for faith and practice, am I going to let the opinion of Wesley or Spurgeon or somebody else affect what I think the Bible does? I want to hear what the Bible says about itself. Now, the first one I use is Matthew 5. I hope you'll open your Bibles to Matthew 5, please, beginning in verse 17. This is where Jesus makes a statement that he talks about Scripture. Every time the word Scripture is used in the New Testament, it always refers to the Old Testament. There is only two verses that imply the inspiration of the New. Only two. Every other time the word Scripture is used, it refers to the Old. And Jesus refers to the Old in some terms that are shocking. It's eternal. It'll never pass away. Not a jot or a tittle will pass away. If you take away, you're the least in the kingdom. Startling statements on the power of the Old Testament. Now, as a professor, I used to quote this a lot to get kids to take the Old Testament, because most people don't want to know the Old Testament. But the Old Testament is the only Bible Jesus had or the apostles had. But then one day I was thinking, you know, I have misinterpreted this. I wanted to use a text to say, take the Old Testament, and I've done just what I preach against. I've used the Bible for my purposes, not for the author's purposes. Because beginning in verse 21 and every paragraph after that, Jesus says, you have heard it said, but I say unto you. Now what Jesus said is, the Old Testament's the Word of God, the Old Testament's eternal, and I am its only proper interpreter. I have authority over it. That's what he's saying. This is a Christological text, not a text about the Bible. Still the strongest words Jesus ever said. So I have tried to list the number of texts here that talk about the inspiration of the Bible. And though it'll take me a little longer to read these, I think it's important for me to read the Bible about why the Bible itself claims its own inherent authority. Would you turn with me first to probably the most classical one, which is 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Now, I usually start in verse 15 because this is where Paul says, bring me the manuscripts and the scriptures which are, you know, able to give you wisdom that leads to salvation. The first purpose, as you remember me saying, of the Bible is to help people find God. The second purpose is to help them learn how to live like Him. And that's verse 17. But right in between that, all scripture, or every, it's the word pos or pon, it means every or all, is inspired. Literally, God breathed. Inspired by God, and is profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, the training in righteousness. There's the first major text. I'm not going to read all these, but would you turn to 1 Thessalonians with me for a second? 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. And for this reason, we also constantly thank God that when you received from us the word of God's message, you accepted it not as a word of men, but for what it really is, the word of God, which also performs its work in you who believe. Would you turn to 1 Peter? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 through 25. You've been born again, not of seed which is perishable but imperishable. That is, with the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all of its glory like the flower of the grass. The grass withers and the flower fades and falls off. But the word of God abides forever, and this is the word which we preach to you. Would you turn over to 2 Peter chapter 1? 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 and 21. But know this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. Would you look at 2 Peter 3, verses 15 and 16? And regard the patience, is that right? Yeah. And regard the patience of our Lord to be salvation, just as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given him, wrote to you. And also in all of his letters, speaking in him those things which some of you hard to understand, which the untaught and the unstable distort as they do the rest of Scriptures to their own destruction. I put this in here because this is the only text, really, that uses Paul's writings on a par with Old Testament Scripture. This is one of the two. The other one comes from the teachings of Jesus, where Jesus quotes a little verse out of Deuteronomy, give the ox his due, you know, talking about paying the preacher. And Jesus added a phrase to that. And the phrase that Jesus added is quoted again and called Scripture. Those are the only two places where the New Testament has this authority kind of implication. I was going to read to you number C on page 13 about how the Old Testament is still relevant for us, but I would like to make this your homework assignment. There's no test. When you get home, would you read these texts on how the Old Testament is still for the Christian? The Old Testament still has a relevance. And now, the Bible's basic purpose. What is the Bible's basic purpose? I have three major truths here. I will not be able to get through them today, but I want to get through A. It is not a rule book. If you turn to Colossians chapter 2, Colossians 2, I want to read 16 through 23. Over and over, people come to my church and want to do Texas alcohol and narcotic education, and they always want to read 2:21. But in context, 2:21 is the message of the heretics. Listen what Paul says about these stinking rules and the people who try to put it on us. Therefore, let no one act as your umpire in regard to food or drink or in respect to festival or new moon or Sabbath day, things which are a mere shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Let no one keep defrauding you of your prize by delighting in self-abasement and the worship of angels, taking his stand on visions he has seen, inflated without cause by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the entire body, being supplied and held together by joints and ligaments, grows with a growth which is from God. If you have died with Christ to the stoicheia, the elementary principles of the world, why, as if you were living in the world, do you submit yourself to decrees such as do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, which all refer to things destined to perish with the using, in accordance with the commandments and teachings of men? These matters, which have, to be sure, the appearance of wisdom in self-made religion and self-abasement and the severe treatment of the body, but are of no value against fleshly indulgence. The Bible is not a rule book. It is primarily a relationship book. Once we know Him, it begins to function as a guideline for us. There are some rules. There are some don'ts. We've just enjoyed adding to them. I always get tickles about our deacon ordination. We want deacons that they can't ever be divorced, and they got to tithe, and they got to come on Sunday night. Now, where'd that come from? Didn't come from 1 Timothy 3. And we never say their own kids have to be well-mannered and disciplined. That'd knock most preachers out, I know, and deacons. And where does no wine come in when the Bible itself says not addicted to much wine? Doesn't say total abstinence. You added that, and the tithing thing, you proof text from somewhere else. And now you've got a list of what deacons should and shouldn't do. Jesus couldn't be a deacon that way because he wasn't the husband of one wife. Piety gives me a rash. The secondary purpose is Christ-like maturity, profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, profitable for training in righteousness, makes believers mature and equipped for every spiritual task. I want to say again, the goal of Christianity is not that you go to heaven. The goal of Christianity is Christ-likeness now. Not judgmentalism, not Phariseeism, not denominationalism, not me-firstism, Christ-firstism. The focus on relationship, not rules. It is not a Christian Talmud telling us everything to do in every area. Rules can become a barrier instead of a bridge. The more things you don't do doesn't open your opportunity for witness. It limits the people who'll talk to you. The Bible does contain guidelines for conduct, but not in every area. Ambiguity is present, and gray areas will be encountered. The major gift is the guide, not the guidelines. We can know enough to live a life pleasing to God. We must walk in the light we have in love, realizing there will always be some ambiguous areas.